Hello everyone and welcome to One Teacher, One Scientist chat room. Our guest today is Ritika Samaddar, the Regional Head of Dietetics at Max Healthcare Delhi. With a 25-year experience in dietetics and nutrition, I'm so honored, Ritika, to have you here in the chat show and understand from you how nutrition plays a role in a child's life.
Okay, so hi Vaishali, thank you so much for having me here. So yes, I think nutrition is very, very critical, and I'm sure all of us have heard about it. The first 1,000 days in our life, which starts not only from the time the child is born, but much prior to that. So we also include the pregnant mother and the child when the child is in the mother's womb is also included. So first important is, of course, the first 1,000 days of the child's life, which actually tells you how the child is going to be as an adult in terms of his health and his nutrition status. But again, post 1,000 days, when the child is into infancy and adolescence, that is also a very, very critical time in terms of what the nutrition the child has. Because remember, whatever the child is eating in terms of the macronutrients and micronutrients, and we're going to talk a little about it in detail, is what is going to make him as an adult in terms of, you know, getting chronic lifestyle diseases or having any kind of communicable diseases or probably simple things like obesity or being very lean or thin. Everything actually starts right from the time the child is born, or even in fact when the child is in the mother's womb. So that how important is when we talk about nutrition in general. And yes, the requirements per kg, what we generally in terms of the nutrition term, what we use is the nutrition per kg requirement is much, much higher when we talk about young children and infancy as compared to when we are talking about in adults. So yes, the childhood is the time where you inculcate good habits, not only in terms of how the child behaves and what the child does, and inculcating, you know, important mental behaviors, etc., but also a very, very important time where you look into the nutritional status of the child and give good nutrition to the child so that he turns into a healthy adult and as a healthy population for the country.
Yeah, so true. I mean, you know, we often find parents stressing a lot about their child's food and nutrition. You know, I often hear parents saying, oh, my child doesn't eat well, he's very thin, or the child has become obese, or he's not eating properly and it's all about junk food. So how much do you think this war between healthy food and junk food is actually justifiable as far as children and parents go?
No, you know, that's very true. I have yet to see a mother or a parent walking into my clinic and saying, you know, my child's eating enough, or, you know, the only problem, you know, the only thing which every mother has in her mind is that probably she's not doing the best for her child, and probably she's not feeding her child right, and she's all the time so concerned. So the first thing which I tell all mothers, that the mere fact that you've become a mother and you have a child at home, you are in fact doing the best job. So one is the guilt factor should never be there, right? So you're feeding your child well. And I know as mothers, we are always very, very tensed about the fact that whether I'm doing the right thing or whether my child is getting the right nutrition and all. So, you know, there are 2-3 simple parameters which I think as parents or as mothers, we should be looking into. One, that I think if the child is very active, moving around, playing, not falling sick very often, I think these 2-3 indicators are the best indicators for us to tell us that whether my child is doing well in terms of nutrition or not. Second comes, of course, when we talk about the height and the weight, and of course seeing whether the child is obese or lean, etc. So yes, again, very, very simple things that, you know, I'm sure when a mother walks into with her child and to a pediatrician or to a nutritionist, we have those simple growth charts, which are very simple way to detect whether your child is actually following the right path of growth or does need some kind of intervention. And again, very important, I know, you know, it's sometimes, you know, it becomes very difficult to tell the mother that, you know, your child is obese or, you know, overeating, and you really need to put a break there. But I think the sooner you get into the right track, the better it is for the child when, you know, when he or she becomes an adult. So yes, it is important to follow the growth chart so that your child is the ideal height for weight, which is very important. Second is, of course, as I said, very important is that your child should be healthy in terms of being very active, moving around, etc. And that can come not only from, you know, we all the time talk so much about the so-called macronutrients, ki proteins khaya ki nahi, fat liya ki nahi. What we are actually forgetting is what we call the hidden malnutrition, or what is the micronutrient. So specifically, as you just mentioned about, you know, junk foods. Now, why is there so much talks about junk foods and all? It is also calories and equally good. The only thing is that when we talk about the so-called junk foods, we are missing out on these so-called micronutrients, which are very, very important, and especially for the children, because this is the time when they're actually getting into the growth stages. So be it simple things like iron or calcium or iodine, these are required in micrograms and milligrams, but they are the most essential nutrients. And hence, you really need to keep a balance when you're talking about a diet, which not only has to be appropriate in terms of the so-called macronutrients, where we talk about proteins and carbohydrates and, you know, giving them calorie-dense food, but also not to forget the importance of the so-called micronutrients, which is, of course, you get it from all your foods, but yes, the key is that you need to just balance your diet. If you're eating everything from the fruits to the vegetables to the cereals to the dairy, your child is getting not only the macro but also the micro, and hence able to maintain the balance in this diet.
Yeah, so true, Ritika. But you know, so do you think a nutritionist can actually be a very important pillar in a child's growth? Like, do you think, you know, parents should actually be having a nutritionist or a dietitian to kind of, you know, navigate through the child's development? Because it's not necessary that every child, or every parent rather, is equipped to handle this balance of macro and micronutrients.
So, so first, of course, I still believe that the mother or the parent is the key when it comes to, you know, talking about the diet and the nutrition part of a child. So yes, she is very, very important, because she understands what the child likes, dislikes, allergies, etc. So yes, she is the key. But yes, it is very important to take some professional help sometimes, and especially in today's day and time when we see so much of disparity. So at one end of the spectrum, we have children who are very highly malnourished, having a lot of these so-called medical issues, etc., and most of them culminating from bad nutrition. And on the other hand, of course, which is of course increasing exponentially, is your problems like obesity and, you know, metabolic syndromes, etc. Again, the major reason for all of it is the wrong diet. So yes, the dietitian, or what we call the nutritionist, does play a very, very important role. And I think for that reason itself, you know, we have a lot of schools, colleges, where in fact I am a part of them, where we are associated with the schools, handling how to monitor the child's nutrition, talking to the parents in case they have any issues, planning their diet plans in terms of what the healthy tiffin should be provided by the schools, etc. Similarly, when we talk in the hospital scenario, whether it's a corporate hospital or a government setup, usually we see that pediatrics is one department where generally you would have one dietitian who is be attached with the pediatrician. Again, for the simple reason, it's not when the child is ill that you want to go and show to a nutritionist, but just to take a overlook of what your child is eating. Is the child into the right part? Is following the growth chart in terms of the height and the weight? And of course, making sure that getting all the micronutrients, which are very, very important. So yes, I do feel that, you know, as the pediatrician, till the time child gets into the adulthood, the pediatrician is a part and parcel of the family. So I think the nutritionist should also become a part and parcel of the entire family to look into the diet of the child.
Yeah, so, you know, like now even United Nations has actually identified malnutrition and obesity as two very important issues, you know, global issues. So where do you think the issue actually lies? Is it because parents or families not understanding the role of micronutrients?
So, when we talk about malnutrition, again, it's three things which we really need to tackle, and each one more difficult than the other. So yes, there was a time till the 1950s and 60s, we were only concentrating on undernutrition. So we had children who were lower than in terms of their height and the weight, and, you know, a lot of wasting happening and all. So that was one category, which of course still exists. But yes, we have come a long way from there because of the various programs which are running in the communities, etc. The other problem, of course, which started in the 70s, 70s and the 80s, and of course now has gone to the next level, is of course the obesity or the overnutrition which is there. Now when we talk about overnutrition, it is not just eating large quantities of food, especially in children, but it is eating the wrong quantity of food. So you know, it's that they are just concentrating on carbohydrate rich foods, or just eating too much of the so-called junk foods, which are just concentrated on calories and the fats, and not talking about the other nutrients. The third, which is again now emerging, and there are a lot of work which is happening in terms of what I said was the hidden hunger, or what we call the hunger malnutrition, is your micronutrient deficiency. Now this is where, of course, as I said, whether we're talking about important nutrients, especially for children, like iron and calcium and vitamin D, because we know this is the time where the maximum growth happens. And if this, during this period of growth, if they lack on any of these so-called micronutrient deficiencies, it would have a lifelong kind of issues which would probably, you know, precipitate later on. So there are three parallel things which are completely different from each, but again each one has its own importance and needs to be tackled in totality. So yes, it's like a warlike situation, especially when we're talking about kids, and because it's a huge spectrum of, you know, a child's age, right from the time the child is born, in fact much before that, when we start educating the pregnant woman about her diet so that the child gets fed properly, till the entire time when the child gets into adulthood, which is till about 16 or 18 years. And each year would have a different requirement in terms of the macronutrients and micronutrients. And of course, I think the major culprit is, of course, a lot of these print medias and the televisions and the kind of advertisements which we have, which actually takes it into the wrong path. And that is where, you know, a lot of correction needs to be done. And of course, educating the public in general is the most important thing if you really want to tackle this issue of both undernutrition and overnutrition.
So true, Ritika. And I think somewhere we need to have these awareness programs for parents so that they can actually disseminate that awareness in their own manner to the child, because the child really looks upon teachers and parents as their role models as well. Like, you know, if parents kind of play the role of a role model, I think the child would follow. So Ritika,
you know, the best thing is, I say that if you just educate the mother, the whole family is educated. So it's very important that the right message goes to the right person, and you know, then the entire family is equally educated and the right information gets into the family.
Absolutely, you know, because in today's times with this digital advancement, there is so much fake news as well.
Yes.
And you know, if you look at WhatsApp messages and what circulates on the social media, there is a lot of information which could just be fake, and parents or people as such need to be educated to discern between what is right and what is not right. Right. However, what do you think of, you know, nutrition as a career, you know, dietetics and nutrition as a career in the 21st century? Where do you find it being positioned in this, you know, this whole bomb of the digital world?
Right. So, you know, this is one profession which I think has come a long way. And again, we have a long path ahead of us. I started my career 25 years back, and I think there were just a few, you could actually count them in your fingers, had a few dietitians in a city like Delhi. And when you move out of Delhi, probably there was no mention, nobody even knew what a dietitian, who a dietitian was, or who was a nutritionist, because we always felt that probably what we were eating at our home, or what our mothers and parents were giving us, was the best thing which was available, right? And we also assumed that probably whatever information we were getting it from, be it your print media or your television, was the right information. But yes, over the years we've realized that again, because of the kind of problems, and it's not only what you're eating but also the environmental factors, which obviously adds on to the, you know, the kind of lifestyle you're leading, has actually led us to all the kinds of so-called non-communicable and the communicable diseases, which are, of course, you know, we are already the diabetes capital. I think the 2030 is what we are aiming at, being the hypertensive and the, you know, cardiology, maximum number of cardiovascular diseases in our country. So sadly and truly, but the country is, in terms of what we say, the health parameters, is not doing so well. And I always feel that prevention is always better than cure. Yes, we do have the latest techniques and the best of doctors, etc., to treat us, but why not prevent it, you know, so that we don't get into that stage? And that is where I think the nutrition plays a very, very important role. And I think as nutritionists, we have a very, very important role, and we really need to take our profession very seriously, because again, as you said, you know, there are a lot of fake news across, and also as nutritionists, it becomes our responsibility to probably provide the right information to the community as whole. So again, if you talk about as nutritionists, it's a very, very vast area of expertise, which of course I'm working in a hospital, so I probably limit myself to just one segment where I get to see people who are not well or need medical help, etc. But nutritionist or dietitian, as we call them, you know, it starts much before. So probably, as I said, prevention is the place where the dietitian should actually be placing herself. So you have wellness clinics, and you have people who can actually provide in the, you know, people who can do writings or print medias, etc. There is a very vast role of a nutritionist even in those areas. And then of course we have a lot of these corporates, or what we call the food industries, which are now coming into the market, where again a dietitian or a nutritionist has a very important role, because again, as we know, when we talk about a junk food, it is only because of the distribution of the nutrition which makes a food healthy or makes a food unhealthy. And again, it is the dietitian or a nutritionist who can actually formulate a food which can be actually be called a very, very healthy food. So she again has a very important role even in the corporate sector, which is your basically food industries.
Absolutely. I mean, I think it can be such a vast field that people with different, children with different skills can actually position themselves wherever they see scope for their kind of skill set. Coming to skill set, what do you think are the key skills that children need if they want to pursue a career in dietetics or nutrition? Just a quick one from you, Ritika.
Yeah. So again, the first thing is, of course, if you believe that prevention is better than cure, then I think dietitian is one role where I really feel you should fit in well, right? Second, very, very important is your interest in learning and, you know, knowing about the recent advances which has been happening, because this is an ever evolving subject. What I read about 20 years back is completely, the science is ever evolving, so it keeps on changing. So if you have that knack to probably, you know, educate yourself day in and day out, read about that language, and of course, you know, evolve from what has happened and learn about what is happening new, this is one stream which you can really will help you, and you will really find a lot of interest. Besides that, of course, communication is very, very important, because, you know, you might have a lot of information, but if you're not able to communicate the right kind of information to the public or to your client for that matter, you're not good at your line. So communication is very important. Your knack to understand or evolve over the new researches which is happening is very important. And third is, of course, you should have a liking for food in general, because obviously at the end of it is nothing but just the food, the nutrition about the food, which makes you a good nutritionist.
Yeah. So I think empathy should also be a part of the skill set.
Very, very important, you know, because at the end of the day, whether it's digital or it is, you know, you have the computers, you have the laptops, but when it comes to a doctor and a dietitian, it has to be that personal touch which will make all the difference. So till the time you do not have that skill of having, you know, being an empathetic person, you would not be able to create that bond, which is very important before you can actually pass on that information or create that kind of a, relationship with your so-called clients or patients.
Yeah, because I feel that bond is so important, and I think that is where the human touch is required, and probably, you know, we can win from the machines and the artificial.
Yes. That's true. Yes, that's true.
Thank you so much, Ritika, for sharing your insights, and I just hope more and more people understand the value behind micronutrients. And not just macronutrients.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Vaishali. Pleasure being in your